Dominion. Thank you for joining me today. While it is very unusual to give this lecture recital in an empty hall, I'm so grateful to have the opportunity to play beautiful music here at Indiana University and speak to you virtually about Schumann's Symphonic Etudes Opus 13. In August of 1837, music critic Carl Ferdinand Becker wrote a curious review, setting the scene with a dialogue among six unnamed figures. The group, confounded by the symphonic etudes, expressed a range of divisive reactions. They argued over the etude's merits, marveling over the combination of genres and critiquing the poor counterpoint and unapologetic changes in key. Indeed, the discussion seems to mirror present-day difficulties with the etudes and Schumann's own struggle to find a definitive iteration of the work. Becker's review leaves us with one marvelous insight, which is told by the third speaker in the group. Haven't you noticed that everything grows bit by bit until the actual finale breaks through and moves forward in a flood? If these are etudes or variations, the finale of Beethoven's Eroica Symphony is also nothing more. In this review, the fictional character's comparison of the symphonic etudes to Beethoven's monumental symphony captures an idea that this piece, despite its ambiguities, transcends genre and technique to embody a profound creative ideal that was held by Schumann and his great idol, Beethoven. The title of this lecture is Reinvention and Creative Ideals, and it is my hope that today's discussion will inspire serious musicians and music lovers alike to make informed decisions, steeping themselves in the philosophy, history, and environment of each composition in order to embody the creative spirit of the music that they are learning. We will begin by examining the merits of Schumann's 1837 publication of the Symphonic Etudes, for which he reinvented the etude and variation genre to confront the Romantic virtuoso tradition. We will then discuss how Schumann's own revisions and republication of the set in 1852 were influenced by his evolving musical ideals. Taking note of the piece's various origins, subsequent revisions, and all of the alterations that were made following Schumann's death, I will conclude this lecture by proposing a performance practice that I believe captures the creative ideals held by the poetic Schumann that conceived the symphonic etudes in the 1830s. Robert Schumann struggled immensely with the etudes. The piece went through 8 different title considerations and 18 years of revision during his lifetime. This period, beginning in 1834, saw a slew of biographical events that may have also contributed to his compositional decision-making. Most interestingly, a broken-off engagement to Ernestine von Fricken. Schumann owes the von Frickens for both the original inspiration and the actual theme of the symphonic etudes. But following Robert and Ernestine's separation in 1835, all traces of their existence in this work were removed. While the piece evolved significantly even before the first publication in 1837, a few constants remained that warrant being addressed here. Firstly, the use of the word etude, then the concept of symphonic, and the idea of variation in form. The etude, study or exercise, that exploits a specific facet of performing technique has a rich history that extends as far back as Durante, Scarlatti, and Bach in the early 18th century. It will be unsurprising to anyone who has taken piano lessons before that this flavor of etude reached its apex in the hands of Carl Czerny, whose prolific output in the genre has remained in the arsenal of aspiring pianists to this day. in the early part of the 1800s, with works like Hummel's Etudes Opus 125, the genre began to transcend mere forays into technical facility in favor of short, virtuosic pieces intended for the concert stage. When discussing these etudes for the concert stage, it is impossible to ignore Frédéric Chopin and Franz Liszt. It is interesting to note that Chopin's Opus 25 set of etudes, Liszt's 12 grand etudes, which are the predecessors to the transcendental etudes, as well as Schumann's symphonic etudes, were all published in 1837. It is natural then to perceive that all three of these sets are in the same vein of conception. But Chopin and Liszt's treatment of the etude genre share certain qualities that set Schumann apart. Namely, each etude of Chopin and Liszt is independent in form, construction, and technical subject. Furthermore, the etudes of both of these composers are organized by key area. As a result, it was, and it remains today, to be common practice to perform single etudes or groups of etudes from these sets, something that seems pretty inconceivable to do with the symphonic etudes. Although I should note that Clara Wieck did extract three etudes for the very first publication of the symphonic etudes, first performance of the symphonic etudes, but this was likely for fear of how they would be received by the audiences. So while the symphonic etudes exercise certain technical challenges, as seen in these three etudes here, their interdependence and unified motivic content distinguish them from the etudes of Chopin and Liszt. In fact, it seems that Schumann's Opus 3 and Opus 10 sets of Paganini etudes find more kinship with Chopin and Liszt than do the later symphonic etudes. Let's take a listen to the first etude from Schumann's Opus 3 set. It is safe to say that Schumann understood the etude genre in a similar way to his contemporaries. So what sets the symphonic etudes apart? The etudes show pieces, concertos, and other genres by several composers of the early Romantic era, exemplified what 19th century critics describe as brilliant virtuosity. The Allgemeine Musikalische Zeitung, which was the main rival of Schumann's periodical in the 1830s, regularly praises the pleasurable and accessible works of composers such as Hummel, Hertz, Czerny, Doller, Kalkbrenner, Moscheles, and even Chopin and Liszt. The aim of these works was best described by Czerny himself in his pedagogical treatise. He said, in dealing with a large heterogeneous public, surely the majority, by far, will be entertained only by pleasant, familiar tunes and will be sustained in spirit by piquant, glittering performances. Schumann certainly had a complex relationship with this style. On the one hand, he was steeped in the brilliant virtuosic tradition as a budding young pianist, regularly practicing works such as the Italian opera variations of Hertz. But on the other hand, he wrote scathing reviews of music that he deemed to be superficial or without substance. He famously wrote, "If I had enemies, I would destroy them by only letting them hear Czerny's music." Harsh. In surveying Schumann's piano music, it is certainly difficult to find an instance of him engaging in this popular style. The lack of overt brilliance in the symphonic etudes sets it apart from the Chopin and Liszt sets, and it may have contributed to its poor reception in the early 19th century. In an 1837 letter to Clara, Schumann writes, "You were wise not to play my etudes. That sort of thing is not suited for the general public. They cannot understand a thing which was not written to suit their taste, but merely for its own sake." So if Schumann was not aiming to please or dazzle with these etudes, then what was the goal? To me, the added descriptor of symphonic gives us a clue. According to early 19th century writers, philosophers, and critics, a foil to the brilliant popular style was the sublime. As musicologist Alexander Stefaniak describes, the sublime became a part of 19th century vocabulary that constructed music as a vehicle for serious thought and transcendental experience. Identifying a piece of music as sublime not only described its intensity, but also asserted its seriousness and cultural prestige. To our modern sensibilities, the sublime in music seems to be rather exclusionary. Michaelis stated that frivolous, feeble, limited temperaments could not understand this music, and Liszt suggested that the sublime could only be perceived by an elevated intellect. And of course, we know that Schumann famously referred to the less high-minded as Philistines. Unfortunately, we do not have time to delve deeply into this topic today, but I would like to suggest that, as uncomfortable as it may be, it is our responsibility as interpreters of past traditions to understand and respect what was held as a creative ideal, not just by Schumann or his Damas Bühler, but a slew of artists, philosophers, and culture makers of the 19th century. To this point, the rhetoric of the sublime is most notably used in E.T.A. Hoffmann's 1813 essay on Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, in which he describes the piece's heroic and monstrous effects. Jean-Paul, Friedrich Schlegel, Herder, Kant, Michaelis, they all applied the rhetoric of the sublime to music, with special emphasis on one genre, the symphony. I propose then that Schumann's use of the word symphonic to describe his etudes in 1837 refers less to the orchestral qualities of the work and more to a reinvention of the etude genre into a work that rejected superficial pleasure and embodied serious artistic values. Recalling Becker's review, the argument about the symphonic etudes revolves around its classification as either etudes or variations. The variation genre played an important role in Schumann's compositional development. The early piano works like Opus 1, Optic Variations, or Opus 5, Theme and Impromptus, are accompanied by several sketches from the 1830s, including a variation on a theme of Beethoven that never saw completion. While the variation set, like the etudes, had been adopted by the brilliant composers for cosmic virtuoso displays, Schumann describes a specific approach to crafting the genre. On the theme, he writes, "I have always been very strict as regards themes, because the entire construction depends on them." And on the variations, he says, "The subject ought to always be kept well in view, but it ought to be shown through different colored glasses." In composing the symphonic etudes, Schumann certainly treats the set in this way. In a letter to von Fricken, he states, "With my variations, I stand still at the finale. I would like to gradually increase the funeral march into a very majestic, triumphal procession." With his funeral march theme, Schumann followed his own advice, taking great pains to craft a theme that establishes large-scale coherence through form and motive in the subsequent etudes. Motivically, the arpeggiations shown above in red comprise the fabric of the theme, and the upper neighbor motion shown in blue is permeated throughout the following etudes. In comparing his original conception of the theme and the one that he used in all subsequent publications, we find that he altered the repeats here in green and the cadential areas shown in purple to create a balanced phrase grouping of four measures each in the form AABA. Formally, each etude that follows retains the structure, with the notable exceptions of etudes 3 and 9. In 1848, with the publication of Album for the Young, Schumann saw an uptick in demand for his music. The unexpected success of Album for the Young was due in large part to the changing cultural aesthetics in Germany, where the popularity of house music, or short, effective pieces suitable for the amateur, was taking hold. The composer was tasked with revising several of his works in the 1840s for renewed publication, including Kreisleriana, David's Müllertänze, and the Symphonic Etudes, among others. With these revised and final authorized versions, the modern performer has perhaps the undesirable choice between two different Schumanns, the poet of 1834 and the corrector of 1852. Schumann's response to this opportunity illustrates his own changing creative ideals. In 1843, he writes, "I used to be indifferent to the amount of notice I received, but a wife and children put a different complexion upon everything. It becomes imperative to think about the future, desirable to see the fruits of one's labors, not the artistic, but the prosaic fruits necessary to life." As a result of this shifting attitude, Schumann's revisions of 1852 show a distinct trimming of the fat effect. And with these 1852 revisions, Schumann fully embraces the variations set as the model for the symphonic etudes, with the most notable changes involving omission of the two odd etudes, 3 and 9, as well as a trimming up of the finale. Significantly, he also changes the title to Etudes in the Form of Variations, omitting any reference to symphonic. The resulting publication is a shorter piece, a set of continuously evolving variations that recall the smoothness of Mendelssohn's 1841 Serious Variations, a piece that Schumann was undoubtedly familiar with. In 1929, Alfred Cortot released a recording of the Symphonic Etudes with 5 additional variations, claiming to be the first to include these posthumous variations in performance. Unfortunately for Cortot, this turns out not to be the case, as 60 years earlier, Brahms gave the first performance in Vienna from a manuscript that contained 5 fantasies, written by Schumann for his original conception of the work in 1834. The publication of what are now called the posthumous variations is rather convoluted. However, they ultimately arrived in the public sphere in 1873, long after Schumann's death. At first glance, these 5 movements are primitive. None of the articulations or dynamic markings are Schumann's, and the ordering is from Brahms. In all, viewing these pieces as etudes or variations makes it difficult to place them within the work. To use Schumann's rhetoric, they seem like inspirations of Eusebius in a Florestan piece. Fierce debate about how, why, and if these variations should be included in performances has further complicated the evolution of this work. So, how can we decide which version best embodies the creative ideal of the symphonic etudes? Whether or not we should include the 5 fantasies, and how? Is Schumann the authority here? Most pianists would say yes, of course. Ironically enough, though, the most widely disseminated version of the symphonic etudes, and the one that is most often performed, is in fact not Schumann's. 5 years after his death, the publisher Schuberth, with a TH, issued a 3rd edition that attempted to reconcile both the 1837 and the 1852 versions of the etudes. And this is the version that we hear most in recordings. So relying on Schumann does not seem to travel much longer. I have chosen to play the 1837 version of the etudes because I believe that they most effectively embody Schumann's poeticism, thwarting the streamlined virtuosic display of the traditional variation set in favor of a creative ideal that echoes the sublime that the title suggests. In regard to the posthumous variations, I propose a rather unusual solution. As you can see, the ordering and the placement of the posthumous variations vary immensely in modern performance practice. Some choose to play them as a set, either at the end or within the work. Others strategically place some or all of the variations within the third edition set. Rarely do we find any justification for these practices. Courtauld, for example, published his edition of the Symphonic Etudes in 1848, with the posthumous variations interspersed within the work without any explanation. My understanding of the five posthumous variations is that they are what Schumann said they are: fantasies on the funeral march theme. In other words, improvisations. In my view, Brahms gifted us with this material and gave us insight into the poetic Schumann's process. In the 1830s, Schumann, by his own admission, improvised more than he practiced the piano. And let's not forget that Beethoven, Mendelssohn, and many of Schumann's contemporaries were considered the greatest improvisers of all time. In an effort to embody this tradition in the present day, without ruffling too many feathers, I have chosen to play the fantasies within the 1837 set Ad Libitum. In order to achieve this in an informed manner, I have made some considerations about the 1837 set. Firstly, that certain etudes define the structure of the work. Most obviously, there are the theme and the finale. However, there are also etudes 7 and 11 that represent an interesting key area progression, outlining the theme itself from C sharp to E to G sharp to C sharp or D flat. In my mind, the proportions should be retained as closely as possible so that the E major etude remains in the center. So if I choose to place a fantasy before etude 7, then one should be placed after as well. This observation is bolstered by the theme's clear, by the piece's clear two-part structure. Etudes 1 and 8 have an abnormal absence of repeat signs, which indicate large section beginnings. This has precedent in the Goldberg variations, with the overture character of Etude 8 further solidifying its role as a sort of beginning. Since the E major etude number 7 completes the first section as the center of the set, I could not place a fantasy between Etude 7 and 8, nor between the theme and Etude 1. A final consideration is choosing the order of the fantasies. As Schumann notes, the set itself extends from funeral march to grand finale. Looking back at Schumann's crafting of the theme, he specifically struggled with the treatment of the subdominant. Observing how the etudes in the 1837 set progress, the later etudes, specifically 6 through 10, have more elaborated subdominants. Of the fantasy, the second has the most obvious elaboration of the subdominant and would therefore be more appropriately placed in the second half. This, along with the natural intensification of rhythm, meter, and texture, would incline me to play the less complex fantasies, numbers 1 and 4, somewhere in the first half. And the driving third fantasy with the second fantasy, somewhere in the second half. The performance practice that I have described is certainly controversial. However, whether you agree or not, I hope that this lecture will encourage you to dive deeply into the world of the music that you are performing and think outside the box to understand and embody the spirit of the music. Thank you so much for joining me today for this lecture. If you have any thoughts regarding this topic, I would love to hear from you. Feel free to email me at timjstep@iu.edu or send me a message on social media. Now, after a brief break, please enjoy the following performance of the 1837 Symphonic Etudes with Ad Lib Fantasies.